Let's take a look at some Java graphics functions. When discussing graphics functions in Java, the very first thing we should review is the paint method. The paint method is built into JFrames, JApplets, and Applets. It is the fundamental method whereby components, polygons, graphics, vectors, and sprites are placed, manipulated, and painted. The paint method always takes a graphics object as an argument. When drawing custom objects on a window background, this paint method is overridden from the superclass. In addition to implementing its own version of the paint method, the class will also place a call to its parent paint method with super.paint and the instance of the graphics object. In many situations, if the parent class's paint method is not also called, swing and aut components will not display properly. Any method that needs access to paint on the window background either needs to be passed to the paint method's graphics object as an argument, or it must call the getGraphics method to retrieve a pointer to the window's background by returning a graphics object. Let's extrapolate things a bit further with the getGraphics method. The getGraphics method retrieves a pointer to the JFrame, JApplet, or Applet's background. This function can be used to get the graphics context of the window when the method is being called outside of the paint method. It returns a graphics object. For example, say we have a function called drawMap, and in this function, outside of the paint method, we need to draw something on the JFrame or JApplet's background. Well, first we call the method getGraphics, which would return a graphics object, so we'll store it in a graphics object called x. We can then take that instance of a graphics object and call all of our graphics functions on it, such as drawLine. Let's examine image objects. Image objects can be used to paint JPEG, GIF, and PNG images onto a JFrame, JApplet, or Applet's background. They are useful for placing still images within a JFrame or JApplet. They are also fundamental in the creation of sprite objects for animation and games in Java applications. Here's an example of how you would use an image object. First, you have to declare one, in this case, ImageCurrentView. When I do this, I need to set it up with a graphics file using the method getImage. Once I do that, I then can call the method drawImage on a graphics object to display that image somewhere on my JFrame or JApplet. Let's review that a bit. Again, after declaring an image object, it can be associated with a graphics file such as a JPEG, GIF, or PNG by calling the method getImage. Once the image object has been set up with getImage, it can be drawn on the window with drawImage. Once again, review. The drawImage method can be used to paint image objects on a JFrame, JApplet, or Applet's background. Its arguments are 1. The image object to be drawn, 2. The x coordinate, 3. The y coordinate, 4. The width, 5. The height, and 6. The window to draw on, usually the this pointer to refer to the current JFrame or JApplet. Here's an example of using image objects in a game. In this case, I'm extending a JApplet, and I've declared all of these image objects here to kind of render the current view of the player. It's just going to display a different JPEG image as they walk around the game. So let's go into our paint method. And in the paint method, down here, I have another function called drawImages. Okay. So we kind of farm out the responsibility of setting up those images there to drawImages. And let me go to drawImages. And in drawImages, I'm simply going to take those image objects, and based on the value of a global integer called location, I'm going to draw out those images on the x and y coordinate of this width and this height. And that's how that works. And that would get called every time, in this case, the JApplet is refreshed, since it's being called from the paint method. And I'll show you that. In this case, it's embedded in a web page here on the website. So let's go ahead and run this.
Click Please start. Enter a name for your character in the input field above. Click the Go, that is an admin. Please choose your character's sex, male or female. Enter your choice in the input box above. There. Click Go to continue.
We turn narration off here. Alright. And in this case, then turn music off too as well. And notice that this is the current JPEG, right? This is my view, and as I walk through and generate images on the map, it's just displaying different image objects.
Warning.
In this case, in the JApplet interface. So you can see how that works. Here's another example. And in this example, I'm implementing KeyListener and Runnable. And of course, this is a JApplet. This is the main interface here. But I just have one image object, current view. And then I have all these separate level classes in a separate package called levels. And even though I only have one image object, here is where I'm actually setting And let me go look for, current view here. In each function, as the player walks from location to location in the game, that's where I'm changing the image that's being displayed with my single image object over here. All right, it's public and static, and I'm just accessing it from outside the class over here in this level data. So current view is being set to the graphics file JPEG. Now also, all of these are being run from within a compressed JAR archive embedded in a web page. So in order to do that, I have to, you know, return a URL object. I can't simply get the class path and load the file, or it wouldn't be able to find it in a compressed JAR archive. So to do that, I wrote a helper function called getLocation. And let me go show you what that looks like. Find it here in the navigator pane. It just returns a URL object. Alright, and I'm calling get class to get where the classes are in the compressed JAR archive, and then get resource to fetch or retrieve the resource from the compressed JAR archive. And I'm returning the URL to that, which would be like a temporary location. So you can see how the image object here has been declared. It's just one, different from the previous example. And you can see where I'm setting different properties on, let me go fish for current view here. And you can see where I'm setting different images on the image object as the player walks around inside the game. And in this example, the way things are, you know, navigated, there's a large switch statement here which controls the game flow. And then I have these two-dimensional arrays here, which where I divide the map up into sectors. And as I walk from sector to sector, I'm just going to display a different JPEG image. And then finally, let's take a look at the paint method inside our interface here, because ultimately, no matter what we do, we still have to do something with the paint method. Alright, so let's go to paint here in the navigator pane. And notice that every time I refresh the interface, I'm simply going to draw that current JPEG, whatever location they happen to be in, it'll change, you know, JPEG to JPEG as they walk from room to room or location to location. But whatever that is, I'm simply drawing that single image on my JApplet background. So again, let's see how that looks. Here's our embedded web page. And let's go ahead and click on play game. And pull this down a little bit here, and we'll start. And let's see, I'll choose FBI. Be a polymorphic hybrid. And let's choose an avatar. We'll go with the first one here. And
lay down your troubled
mind. Okay, and you can see here's the current view. That image object has been updated there. Let me turn the music off here. Alright, I'll turn the music off. Alright, so here's my location on the map. And here's the current JPEG being displayed, and that's just an image object current view. And we'll just walk around the game some, and let's say I look here, there's a door, and it changes to image object. I'll look back against the wall, and it'll change to object. Let me walk over here on the grid some, I'll face the wall, and again it changes to image object. And when found an item there, but this case, now I can face the wall. Same thing. So you can see as I walk around the game, it's just updating that image object. Here's another example, and this is a game project called Pirate Arena. So we have a public static global image object called view. And then let's go to our paint method here. In our paint method, we're calling a function updateView. And if we go to updateView, here, we're taking our image object, our single image object, and we're going to set it to be different graphics, JPEG objects, based on where the player is in the game. So there's two globals, an integer location, in this case we're switching on whether they might be in C1, center 1, north 1, south 1, east 1, east 2, and so forth, and that's these outer cases here in the outer switch. And then each case of the outer switch has its own inner switch. And that is on orientation. And the reason is, not only can the player walk around on the map going north, south, east, and west, four cardinal directions, but the player can also rotate their head and look at different views. In other words, they might be in location north 1, and they can look at the north wall, or the south wall, the east or the west wall. Kind of like in an RPG or a first-person shooter where you might hit the A, W, D, and S keys to walk around, but then you could remain stationary and just move the mouse to turn your head and look around. So that's what we're doing here, and we're just changing the JPEGs. I have the function getLocation, which does exactly what it did in the previous example, so I won't waste time reviewing it. Remember, it just returns a URL object, and again, that's because this game runs embedded in a web page. Now, it's embedded in that web page as a jar archive, and that's why we have to return a URL, or it wouldn't be able to find it in the compressed jar format. And you can see, here's different images as I walk around the game. And I'm just using Key Listener. And as I go on the map, you can see the JPEGs are changing for the view. And let me turn this music off real quick. There, I turned the music off. But I basically just created these images inside of the Unreal 3 level editor. And I just exported them as JPEGs. Just did a screen capture and exported it as a JPEG. But that way it maps my level. And notice I have these two radio buttons here. In this case, when it's set to nav, I'm walking from location to location, and that's that outer switch in my navigation. Now, if I were to set it to view, notice I can look around, and I remain stationary, but I just move my head in this example. And I'm using the arrow keys because I'm using Key Listener. And then I'll switch it back to nav. Let me click nav here. And now I'm actually walking around the map. So just several different methods of implementing and using an image object in game projects. Next, let's take a look at the drawLine method. The drawLine method can be used to draw a line between two points. It takes four arguments. 1, the beginning x-coordinate. 2, the beginning y-coordinate. 3, the ending x-coordinate. And 4, the ending y-coordinate. For example, if I call the function getGraphics to return a graphics object, I can then paint a line on the JApplet or JFrames background with the method drawLine. And then in this case, I would start at x491, y332, and end at x491 and y372. Here's an example of using the drawLine method in code, in which case I'm simply extending JApplet. I have a paint method that I'm overriding, and I'm just going to call the function drawLine to draw some lines. So if we run this, let's see what it looks like. Let me resize my JApplet here. And here I'm just making this cross pattern here with draw lines. Next, let's look at the draw rectangle method. The draw rectangle method, or draw rect, draws a hollow rectangle on the window's background. It takes four arguments. 1, the x coordinate, 2, the y coordinate, 3, the width, and 4, the height. Here's an example. Similar to the draw rect method is the fill rect method. The fill rect method draws a solid rectangle on the window's background. Again, it takes four arguments. 1, the x, 2, the y, 3, the width, and 4, the height. Here's an example. Here's an example in code of both draw rect and fill rect. Here, first, we're going to set the color to black, and then we're going to draw two hollow rectangles with draw rect. It will start at x10 and y10. It'll be 50 wide and 25 high. The next rectangle will start at x100 and y10, and again be 50 wide and 25 high. Then we're going to change the color to blue, and the next two functions will create a solid or filled rectangle instead of a hollow one, since we're using fill rect instead of draw rect. And we're going to start at x10 and y100, and these also will be 50 wide and 25 high. Let's see what that looks like. And you can see, here are our hollow rectangles with draw rect, and here are our solid rectangles with fill rect. Next, we'll examine the draw oval method. The draw oval method draws a hollow ellipse on the window's background. It takes four arguments. 1, the x coordinate to start with. 2, the y coordinate. 3, the width. And 4, the height. Here's an example. The next method, fill oval, is like it. The fill oval method draws a solid ellipse, instead of a hollow one, on the window's background. It too takes four arguments. X, y, the width, and height. Here's an example. Here's an example of both draw oval and fill oval. And in this example, we've mapped things out to two subfunctions, drawCircles and drawFace. DrawCircles will simply demonstrate both drawOval and fillOval. Here we're going to make a hollow circle that will be orange, and it will start at x175, y15, and be 75 wide by 75 high. We're going to change the color to green, and now we're going to draw a solid circle, in this case starting at x175 and y100, and again 75 wide and 75 high. Down here we're going to draw a face, and here we're setting the color to be blue. And once we set the color to be blue, that's the face part, or the first, you know, filled oval in this case. Then we're going to set the color to be black, and we're going to draw two eyes, again filled ovals. And then finally we're going to set the color to be red, and for the mouth we're going to use a function we haven't covered yet, but we'll cover it next, and that's draw arc, and that will simply make an open-ended curve for the smile. So let's see how this works if we run it. And you can see here are the results of both fill oval, the face, and the solid green circle, and also draw oval, which is the hollow orange circle. Next, let's take a look at the draw polygon method. The draw polygon method draws a hollow polygon defined by an array of x coordinates and an array of y coordinates on the window's background. It takes three arguments. 1, the array of x coordinates. 2, the array of y coordinates. And 3, the number of coordinate pairs. In this example, we have two arrays, and they're parallel arrays. So as many as there are x, there should also be y. And when we call draw polygon, we pass in the array of x and then the array of y, and we can use the length attribute of either array to tell it the number of x-y coordinate pairs. Much like the draw polygon method, the fill polygon method constructs a polygon. But in this example, the fill polygon method draws a solid polygon defined by an array of x coordinates and an array of y coordinates on the window's background. It too takes three arguments. 1, the array of x, 2, the array of y, and 3, the number of coordinate pairs. You can see it's declared and called just like draw polygon. Here's an example of draw polygon and fill polygon in code. We have two sets of parallel arrays here, in this case the x and the y coordinates. Now here we're going to set the color to black, and we're going to draw a hollow polygon that will be black, passing in the array of x and the array of y, and then the number of coordinate pairs, which can be determined by calling the length attribute on either the x or the y array. Next, we're going to change the color to green, and this time, instead of draw polygon to make a hollow polygon, we're going to call fill polygon to make a solid polygon. We're going to pass in the array of x, an array of y, and the length attribute, in this case, to specify the number of coordinate pairs. Finally, we're going to change the color to white, and we're simply going to display the string go with the drawString method. So let's see how that looks. Okay, and there you can see the results of both our solid polygon with fill polygon and our hollow polygon with draw polygon. Previously we called the drawString method, so here's a bit more about that. The drawString method draws a string directly onto the window's background without the need of a JLabel or JText area. It takes three arguments. 1, the string to draw. 2, the x coordinate. And 3, the y coordinate. You can also set the font before you call drawString to change the font or the point size. Here's an example. In this case, we set the color to white with setColor. We set the font with setFont. And as a parameter, we instantiate a new font object, Trebuchet MS, as the face. In this case, 0 for a plain font and 14 as the point size. And then we call the method drawString. Refer to our previous example. Remember the two polygons we constructed to make the go sign? Here's the method drawString once again, and you can see we're passing in the string to draw, the starting x and y coordinate. We also said we'd discuss the drawArc method. Remember the smiley face with the smile? The drawArc method draws arcs and open ellipses directly onto windows. It takes six arguments. 1, the x coordinate. 2, the y coordinate. 3, the width. 4, the height. 5, the start angle, and 6, the arc angle. For example, here we're calling drawArc, and we're passing in all 6 parameters as arguments. For an example in code, we'll simply redraw the smiley face we had previously drawn. Here, where we're calling the function drawArc, this is where we're actually constructing or painting the mouth of the smiley face onto the background of the JApplet. So if I run this program, here's what drawArc does. And I'll drag this over here. you can see that it's creating the red mouth and open-ended art. Here's an example of using some of these graphics functions, in this case in a game called Pirate Arena. So in the paint method, I'm calling drawMap and drawPlayerPosition. And first, let's take a look at drawMap down here. And I'm simply setting the color, and I'm using fillRect to create some solid rectangles. In this case, this will generate the map. And then I'm using drawLine to draw some hallways in between them. And finally here, I'm using fillPolygon to construct some solid polygons, in this case octagons, which are for four arenas in the level 1 map. And then again, drawLine to draw some hallways between our rooms. Once we do that, to track the player's position, I'm simply using an oval, or a fill oval in this case. So in the next function that we call from paint, in this case drawPlayerPosition, setting the color to green, and I'm just going to use fill oval and draw a green oval or dot wherever the player happens to be walking in the game. So let's test it out. And in this example, we'll run it embedded in a web page since it starts out as a JApplet. And Pirate Arena, it's a JApplet, and embedded in this web page, I'll click launch. That'll spawn a JFrame, which pops up in front of it. This is sort of the main game window. And I'm just going to click on start and go. And we'll make a destroyer this time. It's implementing key listener, so I can handle that event and use shortcut keys as well. And why don't we turn the music off so we can hear here? And what will we name the fighter? Let's see. Alright, name the fighter. And gender, we'll choose, let's see. And let's set our points for speed and strength. Allocated, ready to play. Okay, so I'll just move the mouse here so you can see, but notice that the player's location is this green circle here. And that's, the ellipse is drawn with fill oval. We set the color to green and we use fill oval. Notice the rooms here are white and they're solid rectangles. Well, they're drawn with fill rect, which creates a solid rectangle that's white. Notice the hallways between the rooms are created with draw line. It's just drawing lines between the rooms. And finally, the four arenas here, these octagons, are created with fill polygon, which creates a solid polygon after we've changed the color object to red. And if I walk around the game, you can kind of see how this works. And I can click on the mouse here, and notice it'll move, in this case, the green oval with fill oval into different locations. And the rooms are drawn, again, with fill rect, and the hallways between them with draw line, and then the arenas themselves with fill polygon. So you can see how that works. Here's another game called Conspiracy, and I'm doing something similar. In the paint method, I have two functions, level 1 map and show location. First, let's take a look at a level 1 map. And the level 1 map will simply draw out the map. And I'm setting the color, and I'm using drawstring to show where I am when I'm walking around the map. And now I'm going to use draw rect, in this case, to create some hollow rectangles. Unlike fillRect in the previous example, where we made solid rectangles, I'm using drawLine and drawString to label different parts of the map. Okay, and if you look all the way down, I'm using drawLine and drawString to create the rooms and label the rooms, and drawRectangle to make hollow rectangles, and changing the color a few times. But you can see how that, how I'm using those methods or those functions to construct or draw a map on this JApplet interface. And then once I do that, the next method that I call is to show the player's location. I call show location. And I'm doing the same thing. I'm just creating a filled oval. And then based on a global integer here, the value of location, as they walk around the map, we'll move that oval to different locations, different rooms. Okay. That game too runs as a JApplet embedded in a web page. So I'm going to run it from a web page this time. And let's just follow the links here. And here's the GUI interface for the game, and we'll click start. And let's see, we've got narration turned off. Let me turn the music off too here. Alright, and I'm just going to choose, in this case, FBI, Charles, polymorphic hybrid. Let's choose an avatar. We'll go to the first one there. And you can see here's the filled oval, and here are the rectangles I'm drawing. These large squares here, that's draw rect, so it's creating the hollow rectangles. Then within the rectangles, I'm making the grid lines with draw line. I'm crisscrossing each of these rectangles with draw line, as well as the, you know, the lines here where I'm moving around with the train. And then I'll just walk around a bit so you can see how the map is drawn. All right, and let me go down. We'll ride the train some. Let me go up. So you can see how I walk around, you know, and it's moving from grid to grid. And it uses a two-dimensional array and some global integers to keep track of the player. And then I'm just moving that, you know, that circle there with fill oval. I'm drawing it in a different location as they move around the game. Here's a game called Mutant Wars, and as in the previous examples, I'm overriding the paint method. When I do that, I'm using booleans here, and in this game, I'm just going to draw the map out one room at a time as the player walks from room to room. So they won't be able to see the whole map at one time until they actually go to a location or a room, and then we'll add it onto the map as they walk around the level. The functions I'm using are draw rect to construct or draw hollow rectangles, and draw line to draw the lines and the hallways between those rooms that are constructed with draw rect for the rectangle. And in addition, I'm also going to turn around and call the method or function draw images from the paint method. And if we go here to draw images, you can see that I'm using fill oval to draw the location of the player in the room. So once we add the rooms to the map, as the player walks from room to room, their position will be represented by an oval. This game too can be embedded in a web page since it's a JApplet. And let me come down here and we'll simply run it. And I'm going to scroll down to the interface here.
Please enter a name for your character in the input field above. Click the Go button to continue.
And I'm just going to turn narration off here. Less annoying. It uses key listener. And again, let me turn the theme music off there. Alright, so notice that the only room the player sees is the one he's currently standing in. And there's the oval with fill oval, and there's the hollow rectangle with draw rect. And then I'm going to walk around the room. So now I'm drawing a line for the hallway from the C1 location, in this case to the next location. And then I'm going to walk again, and in this case, West 1, West 2. I'm going to walk back. Notice that fill oval constructs or draws the oval as I walk from location to location. And I'm using the arrow keys right now to walk around inside the map. And I'm going to go down here and use a cheat real quick just to show you the full map. So I'm going to do this. Let me throw a tilde here. And cheat activated. And let me just walk back up here. In this case, you can see like there's the full map there, but the way that it's set up, it's only gonna, you know, use draw rect to draw the rectangle and draw line to draw the lines when the player actually walks to that location, and then the red oval will move wherever he walks inside the game. Here's an example, in this case an arcade game that also uses graphics functions, and this one's an applet, it extends applet, and let me do Control F, I'll highlight some of the draw and graphics functions here. So here I'm using draw string, and this will simply display lots of information based on the state of the game, whether or not it's over, and then the score and collisions, and then also if, you know, debugging information if the player requests it. And that's toggled on and off with, in this case I have a J frame, and I implement key listener, and if they hit M, it listens for that key, and they press it, this J frame pops up. And they can set all of these attributes in the game here. And it just gets all of this information here and sets it accordingly. Okay, so let's draw a string. Now when we get down here, we're actually using the draw function. Not draw polygon or fill polygon, but the draw method. But what we're passing into it is a shape object, which is a polygon. If you think of draw polygon as a verb, then you could think of a polygon or a shape as a noun. And so essentially this is the same thing as calling draw polygon. I'm calling the draw method. In this case, I have an instance of a graphics2D object, and I'm calling getShape, which returns a polygon or a shape, and I'm going to draw it. And that's for the player, and then not just the player, but the projectiles, and not just the player projectiles, but also the enemy projectiles, and poly enemies as well. These are all polygon objects or shape objects, and as I call the draw method, it returns a shape or a polygon type object. Essentially the same as draw polygon. And if you want to see this in action or see how it works, we can run it here. And then let me hit this. And let's see, we'll change the background color. Same game running embedded within a web page using the same graphics functions. To show you some options there. In this case, I'm creating hollow polygons. Here, let's turn player info on. You can see here's draw string. At this point, let's delve into graphics2D objects. The graphics2D class object extends the capabilities of the standard graphics object and is used with Java's paint method for rendering shapes, images, and text on window backgrounds. Graphics2D objects include built-in functionality for dealing with geometry, transformations, text layout, and colors. It employs a device-independent coordinate system known as user space. Each graphics2D object contains an affine or affine transform object as a data member that allows it to convert coordinates from device-independent user space to device-dependent device space coordinates. When instantiated, a graphics2D object is associated with a target and renders and paints at that target's location. This target and its context are set up by calling the function createGraphics and assigning the return value to a graphics2D object. It works in a similar fashion to the way a graphics object calls getGraphics to retrieve its target. For example, here we instantiate a graphics2D object called paintbrush. We're going to call the method createGraphics, and then once we do, we can use it to draw a rectangle with drawRect. Let's expand on this affineTransform class, or as some call it, affineTransform. An affineTransform class object linearly maps one set of two-dimensional coordinates to another while maintaining the straightness and parallel relationships of the lines between the coordinates being translated. These transformations are applied to scales, rotations, flips, and other transformations. Here's an example. Once again, I call the function createGraphics, and then I'm going to assign the return result to a graphics2D object, in this case called paintbrush. Now I'm going to build an instance of the affineTransform class. We'll call it Optimus Prime, you know, like Transformers. And then we're going to use the function setTransform on our graphics2D object to set it to our instance of Affini Transform, in this case Optimus Prime. And just what of this setTransform method? The Graphics2D setTransform method can be used to set an instance of the Affini Transform class as the chosen means of translation in a Graphics2D application. Example: here we have an instance of a Graphics2D object called Paintbrush. We call the function createGraphics. Once we do this, we build an instance of Affini Transform called Optimus Prime, and we simply use the method setTransform to set our Graphics2D object to our instance of Affini Transform Optimus Prime. You may have noticed the keyword buffer in the previous examples. What was it? It was an instance of the Buffered Image class. So let's talk about that. Buffered Image class objects are used to create polygons, images, sprites, vectors, and other graphics in memory rather than in the visible portion of the screen. Why would you want to do that? Well, this helps reduce flicker and smooth out animations, since images are calculated and constructed outside the visible area where the user can see things. Only when calculations are complete is the entire image or animation frame displayed in a visible portion of the screen. This technique is referred to by many as double buffering. For example, here we create an instance of the buffered image class called buffer. We use the new keyword to build it, pass it in the screen width, the screen height, and we specify that it's going to be an RGB type buffered image object. When we do this, we can then call the method createGraphics on our instance of the buffered image class buffer and assign it to a Graphics2D object. To illustrate this in code, let's take a look at our arcade game Poly Battlefield once again. And I'm going to go down and look for my buffered image object. In this case, we call it buffer. And once we do this, notice that in the init method, which is called automatically when the applet loads, we're building a new buffered image object. Again, passing in screen width and height and an RGB type for the third parameter. When we do this, we can then use our instance of our buffered image class object to call the function createGraphics, and then we can assign that to paintbrush. Well, paintbrush is a graphics2D object. See, here's our declaration of paintbrush. It's a graphics2D type object. So it's set up there. And then once we've done that, we can draw and construct our images and our polygons off the screen in memory where the user can't see. And when the calculations are all done, we'll move them to the visible part of the screen, or in other words, we'll translate them. And this reduces flicker and the amount of time, or the amount of flickering between calculations the user would normally see if we were not using a buffered image object. So let's follow paintbrush. And once we've, set up our double buffering and our buffered image object and assign it to our graphics2D object paintbrush, here we're calling the setTransform method, and Optimus Prime is our instance of Affini Transform. And again, if you look at that, we'll go search for that. Here's Optimus Prime, right? And we're building a new instance of the Affini Transform class. So using our buffered image object and using our graphics2D object and the function createGraphics, we assign it to our graphics2D object paintbrush. Let's go back to setTransform. And we're setting the transformation to be Optimus Prime, our instance of Affini Transform. And then once we do this, we can then use it to draw things. And again, I'm just going to kind of browse through the code here. So notice we're taking paintbrush, we're setting the paint color, and then when we do that, we're going to create a filled or solid rectangle. And I'll skip through some more of the code here. Here we're using draw string, and we're drawing strings here on the background. Again, using our graphics2D object. Let me scroll down some more. So we get down here, now we're using the draw method, and we're drawing polygons or shapes on the screen using the draw method. Now, if it weren't for this setTransform method here, in our instance of Affini Transform, then things just wouldn't work right. And to illustrate, or to show you what I'm talking about, this is, right here is where we're drawing the enemies, or painting the enemies, okay? So if I run this as it is, see what happens. You can see how, in this case, they're all being calculated and drawn off the screen, and successfully translated onto the visible portion of the screen where we can see things. So if I didn't do that, all right, if I didn't set that transformation and I just called translate here, watch what happens when I rebuild the project. It's not what we want. Build the project there. All right, so now I'm no longer setting it to my instance of Affini Transform Optimus Prime. And when I do this and run the project, not what we want, see? Interesting visual effect, but impractical for the game. So you can kind of get an idea of what these objects and methods do and how they work together in a game in terms of a buffered image object, a graphics 2D object, instances of Affini Transform, and the function setTransform to set the transformation. And then when we do a translation, which means moving an object, a polygon, from one set of coordinates to another, it will appear appropriately. And again, now with this function back in place, if I run the game, it does what we want. While we're on the subject of graphics 2D objects, let's throw in the moveTo method. The moveTo method moves the starting position for drawing an object to the specified coordinates passed in as an argument. The method's parameters are 1, the x-coordinate, and 2, the y-coordinate. These parameters are usually specified with f to indicate float point precision. Here, in this example, we're creating or instantiating a general path object, which we'll demonstrate in a moment, and then we're calling the function moveTo to set the starting position to x45 and y90 without drawing anything. And then from this starting position to x90 and y180, we're going to draw a line. Since we've already used it, let's bring up the line2 method. The line2 method draws a line from the previous point position to the specified coordinates passed in as an argument. The method's parameters are 1, the x-coordinate, and 2, the y-coordinate. These parameters are usually specified with f to indicate float precision. Again, we instantiate a new general path object, we set the starting point we move to, and we draw the line from that point to x90 and y180 with the function line2. The previous explanations may warrant an explanation of the general path class, since they use it. General path class objects are used to create geometric paths of straight lines and curves. Using combinations of moveTo and line2, polygons can be constructed as withdraw polygon. For example, here we instantiate a graphics 2D object called X. Then we're going to use it to draw a string on our applet background. We're going to construct a general path object. When we do that, we can then use our general path object to call the functions moveTo and line2. When we're done drawing the line, we call the method closePath, and then finally, we call draw on our graphics 2D object and pass in the general path object to draw the line. Here's an example in code of calling the moveTo and line2 methods and instantiating a general path object. Here we're just going to draw a box. So from the paint method, we call a function drawBox. When we do this, we take the graphics object as an argument, and as we do, we instantiate a graphics 2D object, and here we are casting or converting the data type from a normal graphics object to a graphics 2D object. In this case, our new instance is called BG. We set the color to green, we're going to draw a string, and then once we do this, we're going to instantiate a general path object. When we do this, we're going to move our point to the starting position, in this case x20 and y20. From there, we're going to draw a line to x40 and y20, and then another line, another line, another line. And when we're done constructing or drawing our box line by line, we're then going to call the method closePath on our general path object. Finally, when we're ready to display everything, we're going to set the color to red, and then we're going to call the draw function or method on our graphics 2D object, passing in our instance of the general path class. And here's what this looks like when we run it. Just drawing a simple box in red, and above it is, in this case, the green string using drawstring with the word banana.